What about those who do not see anything when they die? Well, that depends. That effect comes to different types. There are those who do not see within hell but do not suffer. Many of the COVID victims were sent here, those who lived life devoid of faith, refused to accept a religious belief, to be shown a higher, more fruitful way of living life for the benefit of someone other than themselves. They lived life close-minded and genuinely put effort into refusing to better themselves and see their own mistakes and error of their ways. Some do, you're right. There are some who sleep the dreamless sleep until an angel, a cherubim comes and awakens you and takes you away to a better place. This is the death of the innocent children, those who die too young to have truly no evil within their hearts, who did not have the chance to make a choice or realize the right and wrong path in life. The stillborn and aborted infants. I was one of these once. I died and I remember the cherubim. You do not see them but you hear them whisper to you, comforting you, telling you that everything is okay, not to be scared, that you are going to a better place and all your sorrows are behind you as they guide you towards that blissful loving light. Then it ended and I saw the Son of Man in spirit. He told me I was not dead and that I must return. My restless spirit cries for what was stolen from me, my eternal peace, sent back by him to learn the difference between right and wrong and to make a choice which path to take. But my death was not an accident. I was murdered but did not realize it at the time. Then my chance came one day. I saw the one who murdered me and this time he made another choice. My life was in danger and it was he who came to offer me what he had to help me get to safety, so I forgave him and I do not utter his name to this day. But that is not the first brush with death I have heard that I had. From the infirmary at birth I hear that I had died with the umbilical cord wrapped around my throat. At first I was told I was in an incubator for a while but then I came to learn a dark truth about my parents' ties to Anton Lev's cult and pictures of my father in the ceremonies. The hospital wing where I was born burned down 2 weeks after my birth and all my life I have never been able to sit in church without breaking out in hives and sweating profusely. In fact I haven't sat through an entire sermon my whole life and when I pick up a Bible to try and read, when I set it down it feels as though my fingertips are soft, not coarse, as if freshly burned and healed with new skin. I have died 9 times in my life. Heart stopped beating and unresponsive usually for about 5 minutes, then I wake up. Even had an aneurysm and laid comatose for 3 days and then woke up and that time is when I went to heaven and stood before he who is called I Am and was given this name I use now. When I woke from my coma, I fell from heaven back to earth, angry for once again, my eternal peace was stolen from me. At Lakua when I saw his birth, the wise men who were diverted from traveling to Bethlehem when Mary gave birth to him in the barn outside of Bethlehem by an angel that appeared from the shimmering north star and told them the good news, I saw him teaching his gospel speaking to them as I speak to you now, I saw him and his troubles with his impending crucifixion that he struggled with that night in prayer in the presence of his father, I saw Matthew come to warn him of Judas's betrayal outside the house from the Last Supper, I saw him walk in the garden, afterward where he met with an angel who had been tasked with finding Satan, who was known as Bacchus at the time, to devise a strategy to save him secretly from his execution, I saw his betrayal and Matthew cut off his ear for his deed and Jesus stay his hand and walk willingly into custody to save Matthew's life, I saw Jesus in his cell awaiting trial and the discussion between Pilate and him, about how Pilate planned to make sure the world would blame his people for his death and that he was paid to ensure his death by the 2 Sanhedrin priests of the tribe of Abraham and was the same order who petitioned Herod to hunt him before he was born, I saw the mock trial, the truth to the identity of Barabbas, The murderer that was freed was actually his brother, who was being exploited for their uprising of the Jewish movement to protect their traditions from the Roman occupation and their laws. His charges would not condemn him, but his brothers would, so they freed his brother and charged Jesus for his brother's crimes. An innocent man taking the punishment of the guilty was the symbolic death of Jesus that inspired a sense of justice so profound that it shook the very rule of Rome over its people. So in retaliation, the Emperor of Rome had every follower and believer in Jesus's inspiration towards the condemned to their injustice hunted down and imprisoned to be executed as a show of might. And that is what got Caesar killed, knifed in the back and betrayed by his own trusted corrupt council. I also saw the most painful memory. I saw him suffer at the hands of their whip, 8 lashes that stripped the meat from his back, and then they stayed the torturer's hands so that he could walk down the street with thistle brush vines tied to his arms to drag the crucifix down the street while everyone spit on him and condemned him for the crime of another man's deeds. I saw Satan in the crowd, Bacchus, who was the head of a secret order of opulent elite Pharisees. He had arrived too late and only could watch. I saw the devil show remorse and pity towards this man who suffered for the sins of another, to cleanse the trespasses of one so that he may be saved from this fate. Bacchus had this gift of throwing his voice and many times cried out, seeming in one place but really not. He would shout things like, "If you're truly the Son of God, then come down from there and end this suffering drama." But they only shouted louder. And I saw him draw his last breath and knew the pain in his heart. The feeling of abandonment from all he had tried to help, betrayal by those who he called friends, and unworthiness from his father who would not save him in his last moments, as though he wasn't good enough. But only briefly he felt this as he drew his last breath and looked up at the light of the sun as the clouds parted and he saw his father descending from heaven. He said, "Father, why have you forsaken me? It is done." And he died as was the plan of God the whole time, and he knew why, because at that moment a bright light erupted from within him. The angelic forms of the three wise men, who had appeared before Abraham, Isaac and Jacob and Moses and the Hebrews, burst forth from within him. The Trinity angels of God's hands of creation separated upon his death as was planned before the earth had been made, caught up and entangled from their duty. Through the resurrection, all three had each awakened from their deaths, sending them back to finish what had begun at the beginning of existence, each one having slumbered in death for 3.5 days. Their anti-gay protests are symbolic to the devil and pride. "What? You're kidding, a symbol of pride? Like anti-gay symbolism? What makes you think that angels, who have no actual gender for they have no sense of sin, it's not within their process of thought, would abolish anything that is tied together out of love? Do you think that the angels who were sent to Sodom and Gomorrah were sinned upon with acts of sodomy and fornication as well? If so, then you should take it as a lesson that you do not truly know or understand the matters that go on in heaven. For if you did, you could ask the angels themselves what happened, and they would tell you that it was not that way. That they had tried to lead them away from their loyalty to God with tasks and tests that were set up for them to fail, and have doubt in God for their failure. That which they endured by their schemes and temptations is what got Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed. Homosexual love is still love and should not be looked down upon. Just as one loves his dog or the beauty of the sky or any wonder of God's creation, and so that love is good and pure, so too is the love between two men or women pure, and it too should not be abolished or looked down upon. You wish to know how Jesus cast out demons? How a true exorcism was preformed by the Son of Man, the humble teacher, Jesus, Spirit who haunts this place. Show yourself and make yourself known. Spirit, why do you bother me, priest? Jesus, how many are with you here? Spirit, we are many. Jesus, reveal to me what troubles you. Tell me why you linger and haunt these people so harshly. Spirit, by whose authority do you bear to fix my problems? You are no great man of renown. Jesus, I am a man who will listen without judgment against you, who will seek to help you to restore peace in this house. spirit, how do we know you speak truth? Jesus, you don't, but you have my word. That's all I shall give, for only deceitful men display wonders and signs in the skies. Men of truth stand by their word. Spirit, what you speak is wisdom very well. Jesus, come as a show of peace, so that I may go towards helping you find rest. Dwell within these pigs, so that they know you shall not bring chaos upon them until I find the answer to your problems. Spirit, very well. And the spirits would go, and he would keep his word, and the spirits would leave their house. As far as Lilith is concerned, she is, well, let's just say, a bit panicked at the moment. She realizes that I know who she truly is and the entire backstory of Cain and his situation with Lilith. You see, Cain never encountered Lilith in the time after Adam and Eve and the garden. It was a past life memory of his life that got him cast down as Cain. You see, here recently I've had to deal with someone who is very arrogant and full of lies, the bride of heaven's prior relationship. He is obsessed with trying to get revenge and claims he was a victim. Blah blah blah. Well, I finally got tired of his bullshit that I stole a portion of his soul and sent it back to be cursed to live the life of Cain for 70 generations and walk the earth as him. Cain's claim to Lilith was his past life memories of the Bride of Heaven, and his claim to Lilith being stolen from Adam by Samael is his memory of her choosing to be with me over his arrogance and us raising her daughter. The one who appeared before Cain and took on the role of Lilith to ease his angry spirit was the angel of the water bearer for this world, Gaia, a spirit that was present since the earth began, one of 436 angels I created and sent out across the span of existence to gather the surrounding elements that can create a sustainable ecosystem for life to flourish in various forms depending on the available elements and habitable conditions. I call them the angels of the cup bearers of the water of life. It was her who appeared before Cain and sympathized with him until she realized the basis of his story portrayed him as a tyrant and took sides with the figure of Samael in his memories, and has basically searched and waited to find the man he ranted about to finally complete her story and enlighten her to Cain's past life memories. So she has been watching from a distance, knowing the story of you and me and our destined dance to come. I think she has taken up a role against you in my defense. They do not speak to anyone, nor are they allowed to be disturbed from their work. They work unseen and intangible, most species probably aren't even aware of their presence. They do not involve themselves with what goes on or how life develops. Their only purpose is to bring together the elements that make life possible.